the government wants you to help protect copyrighted works online. This is what I would call an RFC, request for comment. The U.S. Copyright Office is announcing a series of consultations on technical measures to identify or protect copyrighted works online. This is like Content ID or watermarking, other measures that could protect copyrighted works, could identify the use of copyrighted works. And this is the government asking whether they should get involved. Right now, the government's not involved. All that it does is provide copyright law, and then it's up to the content owners and the content users and viewers and other creators to enforce their rights through out-of-court and in-court action. Yeah, getting the government involved is certainly one option. I'm equally skeptical that the government could do a good job with something like Content ID, but that's what this is for. This is for you to comment on and provide ideas and evidence and really anything you can think of that you think will help to the Copyright Office. It has to be provided by February 8th. We'll go over that. The office, the Copyright Office, plans to hold a plenary session to launch consultations on this issue on February 22nd, 2022, to be followed by small sectoral consultations thereafter. To aid in this effort, the office is seeking public input on a number of questions. Written statements of interest to participate in the consultations, along with a response to at least one of the questions in this notice, must be received no later than 11:59 p.m. Eastern Time on February 8th, 2022. Written comments may be made for the record without expectation of participating in the consultations by the same deadline. I think we have, especially this audience, has a lot of experience with what's going on with copyright in the world right now, so I think we should make some application. The office plans to hold February 23rd as a possible second day for the consultations. Subsequent industry sector specific consultations will be announced at a later date via copyright.gov/policy/technical-measures. Right now, that is just a statement about the consultations, which says basically the same thing. For reasons of governmental efficiency, the Copyright Office is using regulations.gov for the submission and posting of public submissions. All submissions will go to regulations.gov. Specific instructions can be found on that technical measures website that we just looked at. The office is now announcing that it will convene a series of consultations on technical measures for identifying or protecting copyrighted works online. Over the past decade or so, rights holders across industries have developed and employed various technical measures to assist with the protection of their works. From our perspective, from the small creator and copyright user perspective, the fair user perspective, we're concerned about how none of these systems seem to incorporate any kind of protection for fair uses. Instead, it seems to be a shoot first and ask questions later approach. You get some sort of Content ID hit, the automated system implements whatever the content owner has set for that Content ID hit, and then the fair user has to reply and say, hey, wait, this is a fair use. Meanwhile, the content is either demonetized or taken down, depromoted, flagged for something. You could get a copyright strike that you then have to appeal. And appealing means providing your identifying information to the person, the content owner making the claim. So some people are conflicted about this. They don't want to go through that process because it's a lot of work and they're not making a lot of money already because they're a small creator. Sometimes there are complaints that they don't want to provide identifying information. And there's even been a situation or two where someone has made a claim specifically to get that identifying information and identify someone who is trying to remain anonymous or pseudonymous. Rights holders have used digital watermarks, standard identifiers, and other tools to facilitate the use of their works, including downstream uses, while maintaining attribution and other copyright management information. Content ID, for example, scans videos that are uploaded to YouTube against a database of files that have been submitted by copyright owners participating in the program. When a match is made, the owner is notified and has the option to block the video from being viewed, monetize it by running advertisements, or track its viewership statistics. And we've seen this abused, right? We saw the scammers who fraudulently obtained $20 million in revenue from YouTube from music creators who had licensed their works to be put on YouTube. This scamming company, Media Move, I think it was, had told YouTube that they represent 50,000 songs, and YouTube just said, sure, here's the revenue. Then again, I'm sort of biased against Content ID because Content ID has only ever been used against lawful masses. It has never really been used for lawful masses. The people or the situations where we've identified lawful masses content on other platforms illegally has been from the viewers who care about lawful masses and told me about it, not that YouTube identified it. While these collaborations and technical measures may constitute reasonable, effective, and flexible approaches to curbing online infringement, as the office noted in its Section 512 report, their strictly voluntary nature presents inherent limitations. The absence of comprehensive coverage and the exclusion of certain stakeholder interests during the development stages could hinder a measure's sustainable success. One commenter to the Section 512 study noted that voluntary initiatives can create potential for disadvantaging those who are not involved in the relevant discussions or parties to the ultimate agreement, including the public, creators, and providers of innovative new services. And then let's include small-time creators there. For instance, Lawful Masses does not have access to YouTube's more advanced Content ID system. I believe there is a simple Content ID access for small creators. I don't know if it kicks in at a subscriber number or whatever. We're past 100,000 and YouTube says that it will identify copies of our content and then tell me about it, and then I can manually go in and do something. But I don't have access to the larger Content ID, the automatic part of the system. The office therefore recommended in the Section 512 report that a key feature of any future voluntary measure should involve cooperation among rights holder organizations, all sizes of online service providers, individual creators, and users. Great. So what we could see out of this and what we could make a comment and participate in consultations potentially would be that these measures need to be by law regulated to be available for everyone. Everyone who creates should have access to the same features of Content ID that larger creators have or larger rights holders have. In addition to inclusivity, the office also emphasized the importance of flexibility, accountability, and comprehensive reporting. Accountability is really important. Currently, it's a lopsided system. A copyright, or rather just a claimant, doesn't even have to be a copyright owner, can make a claim and you lose your revenue, but your only reaction or your only recovery at law is to make a Section 512F misrepresentation claim, and you get your actual provable damages. But then the copyright owners who have registered their copyrights, they get access to the statutory damages regime. Why don't we have a statutory damages regime for people who make intentionally false misrepresentations of content? Instead, you only get actual provable damages, which is hard to prove. The content gets taken down and you have to say, well, this video was going to go viral and would have gotten 2 million views, but you took it down illegally. And you have to prove that somehow you're sure that that would have happened to some convincing level of claim. And I don't see that that's happening. The statutory damage system is meant to cover those cases where a number can be assigned, even though we can't show what the actual damage is, just that something happened and that it's likely that there's damage. And sure, the judge will try to put a statutory damage number on that's appropriate, but there's no requirement for you to actually prove the actual damages. So if we had better accountability in the system, that would be better for people to respond to false claims, and that would also then make copyright owners think twice before they take down material that is arguably a fair use. Consultations. The consultations will address current and forthcoming technologies for identifying or protecting works online, including the technology's availability, their use cases, and their limitations. The consultations will consist of one plenary session and a series of smaller industry-specific sessions. Members of the public who seek to participate in the consultations should submit via regulations.gov a written statement of interest answering at least one of the questions listed below. The Copyright Office strongly encourages participation by individuals with experience currently using or developing relevant technologies. Both the plenary and industry-based sessions will be held virtually over Zoom. Here are the questions. Below are questions to consider ahead of the plenary session, as these topics will underlie the discussion. Please provide an answer to at least one of these questions in your written statement of interest to participate in the consultations in order to assist in effectively organizing these consultations. For those who do not wish to participate in the consultations, the office will also accept, by the date above February 8th, written comments for the record responding to at least one of the questions below. For rights holders, please identify any technical measures currently used or in development by you, your organization, company, industry, or sector to identify or protect copyrighted works online. How do these technical measures affect your ability to protect your copyrighted works online? Online service providers, please identify any technical measures currently used or in development by your organization, etc., to identify or protect copyrighted works online. How do these technical measures affect your ability to provide services to your users? Users, how are you, your organization, company, industry, sector, affected by technologies implemented by rights holders and service providers to identify or protect copyrighted works online? This is your chance. If you are one of these users who has been negatively affected by Content ID, this is your chance to tell the government directly. They're asking for you to tell them how you have been affected positively, but I'm thinking of all of the people who have been negatively affected by Content ID and by false copyright claims. I know that 512F is not necessarily the scope of this questioning. We're focusing more on Content ID style systems, but this is the chance to say, I got falsely claimed because of Content ID, and there was nothing in place to require the content claimant to properly identify my fair use and only then send a claim. And then the fourth question, to what extent are any of these technical measures being adopted or discussed as part of any within industry or cross industry endeavors, initiatives, or agreements? Five, are there any other processes that are ongoing for identifying voluntary solutions or to identify and implement technical measures? Are there alternative processes other than those that may be currently in place that would better identify and implement technical measures? Please be specific, as different technical measures may have different solutions in different industries. To what extent would the adoption and broad implementation of existing or future technical measures by stakeholders, including online service providers and rights holders, be likely to assist in addressing the problem of online copyright piracy? What are the obstacles to adopting and broadly implementing such existing or future technical measures? Would the adoption and broad implementation of such existing or future technical measures have negative effects? If so, what would be the effects and who would be affected? This is a great question for these victims of false claims to answer. And we really should try to, either through mass comment or through some sort of unified effort, we really should make sure that Congress knows, the U.S. Congress knows, what the effects of these measures are when they are implemented improperly. The other thing they're talking about here is online copyright piracy. And we have seen that because of these measures, pirates often get a better user experience than the people who buy their material. I can go on some BitTorrent website or other file sharing website, and I can pirate the latest movies and have total portability and total control over my use of that content. But heaven forbid I pay for my content properly and obtain an authorized copy. I'm limited by where I can play it, what device I can play it on, whether I can download it for play offline, and generally have a much worse user experience. And I personally have a lot of experience with this now that I live in Luxembourg, which is a tiny country, often called a microstate, and content owners tend to forget that it exists. So I might be able to go across the river a kilometer away and play my content in Germany that I purchased on my Google Play account in the United States when I was there. But then when I'm over the river here in Luxembourg, I might not be able to play it. It's disabled in my country because the content owner forgot that we exist. But if I pirated it, I'd have a great user experience. Of course, there's negative sides to piracy too. I could get viruses, I could get a low quality copy, I could waste my time. But in general, if you are able to obtain a pirated copy, you have a way better user experience. Of course, at the risk of legal enforcement, I'm not condoning piracy. But for the answer to question six, we should all make sure that Congress knows that pirates have a better user experience than genuine authorized content purchasers, people who purchase licensed authorized copies, because these systems are overbearing and burdensome. Question seven, is there a role for government to play in identifying, developing, cataloging, or communicating about existing or future technical measures for identifying or protecting copyrighted works online? Can the government facilitate the adoption or implementation of technical measures? And if so, how? Are there technical measures or other standards used to protect copyrighted works online of which the government should be aware when implementing statutory or regulatory provisions, such as requirements for procurement, grants, or required data inventories? Grants. That means that if you want to develop a system and it's substantially costly, as we saw before in Section I of 512, you might be able to apply for a grant if you tell the government you need grants and then they make a law that allows you to apply for grants. So these are opportunities for innovative people to help sculpt and mold these future regulations, some of which we might want to see, and some of which we might want to change existing regulations. Eight, please identify other pertinent issues not referenced. For both comments and statements of interest, please indicate which questions you're answering. For those who wish to participate in consultations, please indicate your organization's request to participate and who will be participating by name, title, and contact information. That was issued on December 16th. I've only just seen it now. It is issued by Shira Perlmutter, Register of Copyrights and Director of the U.S. Copyright Office. I think that's great, and I think we should all take this chance. This is a once in a while, maybe even once in a lifetime opportunity to interact with the Copyright Office on exactly the problems that, well, one of the many problems that we as copyright creators, fair users, viewers see in this system. And I think that this would be a great opportunity for all of us to write something. It doesn't have to be big. It could be a page or two. It doesn't have to be a huge legally formatted submission. It can be a very basic submission. Imagine if they received 10,000 letters from copyright viewers talking about how horrible Content ID has been. For all of the good things that it does, I don't want to knock it completely off the system. Content ID does a great job for the vast majority of situations, but it also enables these terrible situations where people get even one false claim or hundreds of false claims, and then they have to respond to all of it with no recovery or no remedy, without having to file a lawsuit that is expensive and they might not be able to maintain. It's a very difficult situation for people who are victims of this. And I think this is a great opportunity for all of us to band together and either write en masse or write as a unified effort. So let me know what you think in the comments below. Put your ideas in the comments below as well, and I will incorporate those ideas into my submission. And I will ask to be a participant in the consultations. I don't expect to be granted the ability to be a participant. I'll probably just end up being a viewer, but I will submit something on my behalf and in general for what I've seen in the YouTube community and the and other online content creation community. Let me know your thoughts in the comments below. Let me know what you think should be in this submission in the contents below. I've said content too much this video. In the comments below. Thanks. Thanks for watching. Special thanks to our top supporters in January: John Steele, Gavin Barnard, Evie, Spirit Bear, Benjamin Hightov, Ugly Grill, Torpedon, Not Mike, Shadow Tycho, Earthbound Star, Tech Tech Potato, Eric Tams, Pure Magma, and the Blood-Soaked Survivors. You can support Lawful Masses on patreon.com/LJFrench, sponsus.com/law, through YouTube memberships, and through Floatplane subscriptions. Join me for our weekly live production stream on twitch.tv/lawfulmasses on Sunday mornings at 10 a.m. Eastern U.S. time. I hope everyone has a great week and a happy new year. I love you all. Bye.